Hello everybody, welcome to the next lecture on the quadratic programming problem. Myself Dr. Garg, and today I just explain you what is the meaning of the Bell's method and how it helps to solve the quadratic programming problem. So if there is any doubt regarding this video or any other video, you can contact me either through my email ID, through my personal website or through any YouTube channels out there. So what is the quadratic programming problem? It is also abbreviated as a QPP. So any function which can be written in the form of the linear plus quadratic is there, subjective to some constraints. So this function can be maximization or minimization. The only thing is that this Q must be a symmetric matrix system. So in order to solve this QPP, we have the two methods, that is the Wolf and the second one is the Bell's method. And the Wolf method we have discussed already in the last lecture. You can go through this link or you can see in the description part also. So you will be able to understand how to solve this Wolf method. Now today's we will discuss about this Bell's method. So that's our today's presentation. So what we have studied in the Wolf method is that it totally depends upon the Kuh-Tucker conditions are there. That is, the QPP is solved with the help of the Kuh-Tucker conditions. So while on the other hand, this Bell's method, that is a Bell's, is a one of the mathematicians which we develop a technique which do not use the Kuh-Tucker conditions. So what we did, what he did in this suggested method is, they just divide the variables into the two parts. One is called as the basic, we denote it as a XB, B is for the basic, and second is the non-basic variables are. And then once we divide this basic and non-basic variables, then we express all those basic variables and the objective function in terms of their non-basic variables. And then we will try to maximize the problems or minimize them. So in order to explain it, I just illustrate with a numerical example. Make sure that you can express the objective function in terms of the maximization always. There is no hard and fast rule that it is not applicable for the minimization problem. You can do for the minimization problem also, but the rules which I suggested in a couple of slides are reverse. Okay, so I just suggest you that you can always convert the maximization problem, a minimization problem, to the maximization. So I just try to solve the two examples. One is related to maximization, second is related to the minimization. So let's first example is there, using the Bell's method you can maximize this subjective to these constraints are. So always remember that firstly the maximization is there, that's always true. Then write in the standard form. So since it is a maximization, there is no worry. So since it is a less than sign, so we can use this slack variable sign. Now look at that, how many constraints are there? So m is my number of the constraints. So since there is only one constraint, so m is my one. How many decision variables are there, which is calculated after converting into the standard form? If you look at here, then you will find that the number of the decision variables are 2. But in the Bell's method, whenever you have write in terms of the equality, then count the number of the decision variables. Now, what we do is, now since this is a problem, so what is that you initially choose, since we need discretize this variable into the two part, one is the basic and the non-basic. So basic part is corresponding to m and this part is corresponding to the n minus m. So how many m's are there in, look at that in the last slide, m is my 1. So it means you can choose out of these three variables one as a basic variable and the remaining are the non-basic. So I choose just arbitrary as a s1 as the basic and x1 and x2 are the non-basic. You always choose s1 starting that so that you can easily understand the methods. So what we do is that now, what is the working rule to solve with the help of Bell's is, you can express the basic and the objective function in terms of the non-basic. Once you do that, you can find the entering and then leaving it. So let's start with them. So since this is a problem, I choose the s1 as the basic variable and x1 and x2 as the non-basic. So you can express xb, that is s1, in terms of the non-basic, that is x1 and x2. So how you choose them? So since this is the expression, you can find the value of the s1 from here. So what is the value of the s1 here is, that is 4 minus this, and substitute this value in the fx. So since there is no s1 is there, so f is remain the same. So this is my step 1. Now step 2 is how to find the entering variable. So the simple rule is, you can differentiate this with respect to the non-basic variables. So how many non-basic variables are there? x1 and x2. So differentiate this with respect to x1 and x2, you will get this. After that, you will find the point that is where the known, since the value of the known basic variable always be 0, so substitute this value in these equations, you will get this one. And the rule for entering the variable is, since my problem is the maximization, so you will find the most positive part. So since this is the most positive part as compared to the x1, so therefore this is corresponding to x2. So x2 is my entering variable. So since my problem is maximization, so that's why I'm just taking the most positive part. If you want to convert into the minimization, then opposite sign will be taken with that. So x2 is the entering variable. Now, how to find the leaving variable? So what is the meaning of the entering variable is, since initially is S1 is my entering basic variable, now in the second iteration, what we'll do is X2 will be my entering variable. So what about the S1? Whether it is a leaving variable or not, that we will check that. So how you find the leaving variable? That is the rule of this. What is the meaning of this? So there are the numerator and the denominators are there. Always remember that what is the rule is, numerator is always be the constant, while denominator is the coefficient of the entering variable. In this case, what is my entering variable is x2. So this is my coefficient of the x2. What are two alphas and the gamma? So look at the, what is xb is s1. So the first alpha representing for the s1. What is meaning? Look at the equation of the s1. This is the equation of the s1. Look at the constant term. So what is this? This is the minimum of, what is the constant? What is the constant of the S1? That is 4 divided by mod of coefficient of the X2 in this. So coefficient of the X2 in here is -2, comma. If there are another X2, X1 also is there, then you can find also coefficient of the X1. That will be seen in the next slide. This gamma represents is the variable is X2 is my entering variable. So the partial derivative of this. So gamma is representing for my partial derivative. So this is x2 is my entering variable. So look at this. What is the coefficient of constant term? What is the constant term is 6. What is the coefficient of the x2? Entering variable is my x2 in this partial derivative. So this is my -6. Okay, so that is the meaning of it. So look at that. This. So what is the minimum is? So since minimum is my 1, that is corresponding to this part. This means this part. So this is 1 that is corresponding to gamma. So it means my leaving variable is this, and this is this corresponding to this portion. So, and since this partial derivative does not belong to any of this variable, so we introduce a new variable that is called as non-basic variable. I represent as a u1, nothing but the half of this. So you can find the half of this is here. If, for example, if I say the minimum occurs corresponding to this, so it means this is corresponding to the first, that is my nothing but the S1. So I can say that S1 is my leaving variable. I also consider this in the next example. So I introduce the known basic variable as a U1. So what is the meaning is that in the next iteration, what is that now S1 is not the leaving variable. So S1 is remains same. X2 is my entering variable. And now what is the known basic variable is, since X2 is the move on the basic variable, and we have introduced the new basic variable out there, non-basic variable. So look at that. This now repeat the step again. Now since we need to express the basic variables in terms of the non-basic, so S1 and X2 are there. So use this last deriving, and these are the values corresponding to these terms are there. So I have used these values always, and the new values are there in this table. Find the value of the x2 from this equation, you will get this. Substitute the value of the x2 in the expression of the s1. Okay, so that it becomes the x1 in terms of the x1 and u1. So look at that. This is the function in terms of the x1 u1. This is the function of the in terms of the x1 u1, that is a known basic variable. And similarly, substitute the value of the x2 in this equation f, you will get this expression. Now the how to find the entering variable, partial derivative with respect to the non-basic variable. What is the non-basic is x1 and u1. So x1 and u1. So derivative this with respect to the x1 and u1, you will get this. Now at the point where it is non-basic variable is 0, you will get this answer. Okay. So what is the most positive part is 4. So it means my entering variable is my x1. Now how to find the leaving variable is, now since there are the two basic variables are there, so there are the two gammas, sorry, two alphas are there, and one alpha is corresponding to s1, second alpha is corresponding to s2, and this gamma is corresponding to partial derivative with respect to the x1. So if you calculate the value of this, what is the s1, what is the equation of the s1 is here, what is the constant term is my 2, what is the coefficient of the x1 in the s1 expression, what is the coefficient of the s1 is minus 1, comma. Second term is alpha is represented for x2, look at the expression of the x2, this is the expression of the x2, what is the constant part is 3 divided by 3 is 1, what is the coefficient of the x1 in this, so nothing but the 0, comma, what is the coefficient of, what is the constant term in the this one, that is nothing but 4 divided by minus 2. So look at that, these values are there. This, and since the minimum value occurring corresponding to this as well as this, both are the same, so I can either use this or as this, so I have used this, so this is my minimum value I have taken. So since this is corresponding to the partial derivative, so I have to introduce again a new variable u2. So it means my new xb will be, this is the entering and this is their leaving. Now I have considered these values and this u2 again representing here. Now again use this one to find the value of the x1 here, because my task is to represent x1, x2, s1, x1, x2, x1 in terms of the u1 and u2. So you can find the value of x1 from here, substitute this x1 value in x2, since there is no x2 is there, so this value is remain same, and so on. Now again find the entering variable. So partial derivative with respect to the u1 and u2, you will get this, and add the point here is there. So since this value is 0, so my current solution is optimal. Okay? So how you find the optimal answer is, you can substitute the value of the u1 and u2 in these expressions, you will get this final answer. So this is the way to solve this Beal's methods is there. So you can move this step until unless the partial derivatives are either less than or equal to 0 for the next position. Since both are the 0, so it means my optimal is there. If instead of that, if we say this is my minus 4, then again this is optimal, because my task is to find the most positive. So this is not be a positive value. Okay, let's move one more example so that it will clear you easily. So here I have considered that two constants are there instead of the one, and my problem is the minimization. So just write in the standard form. Firstly, I just convert into the maximization by just multiply with the negative sign. And the constants are put up in the equality by using the surplus variables are there. That is minus s1, minus s2. So how many constants are there? There are the two. So m is my 2 and the number of the variables are 4. So I just choose, since m is 2, so I have to choose the two arbitrary variables. I consider the s1 and s2 as my basic and the remaining are the non-basic. So let's start with the equation 1. So express this s1 and s2 in terms of the x1 and x2. So use these values. Find the value of the s1 from the first expression. Find the value of the s2 from the second expression. And since objective function is already in the terms of the s1 and s2. Now find their entering variable, partial derivative with respect to the non-basic variable, that is x1 and x2. So you can derivative this with respect to x1 and x2. And substitute the value as 0. So you will get this. So the most entering variable, most positive variable is 4. So my entering variable is my x1. Then you have to find the leaving variable. So since there are the two s1, two basic variables are there. So one is corresponding to s1, second is corresponding to s2, and this gamma is corresponding to the partial derivative with respect to the s1. So look at that. This, what is, look at the first part is corresponding to s1. So this is the expression for the s1. What is the constant is minus 6. Coefficient of the s1, since entering variable is x1, so the coefficient of the x1 is my 2. Look at that, this expression. Second is corresponding to s2, so look at the expression of the s2. What is the constant is 0, so this is 0 divided by the coefficient of the x1, that is 1. Look at for the gamma side, gamma is the coefficient partial derivative with respect to the x1, entering variable is x1, coefficient constant is my 4, 4, and coefficient is minus 2. So what is the minimum is? So since it is minus 3, this is 0, this is plus 2, so here. So look at that. Now this, in this time, this is S1 instead of the gamma. Okay. So it means my living variable is S1. So in this means, in next one is my entering variable is X1. So X1 is my entering. So since this is living, so it will move on this one. So the non-basic variable will be my X2 and S1, because S1 goes on this side. So look at that. Now my task is to represent X1, S2 and F in terms of the X2 and S1, non-basic variable, and then find the entering and leaving. So how you find that X, since we need X1, so we can, and we, and since S1 is not be needed, so you can find the value of the X1 from here. You will get X1, substitute this value of X1 in S2 and F, you will get this expression. Now how you find the entering variable? You can do partial derivative with respect to the non-basic variables. So the non-basic variable is my X2 and S1. So X2 and S1 is there. Now substitute the value 0, you will get this. So what is the most positive part is? This is the most positive part. So my entering variable is X2. So entering variable is X2. So you can find the living variables. So again, there are the two alphas and one gamma corresponding to this X2. So what is that? What is the constant part for the X2? So look at that, constant part is 3 divided by the coefficient of the X2, that is minus 9/2, and so. And look at that, what is the minimum part is corresponding to this. So it is 2/13 corresponding to this. Okay, so since it is a gamma, so we have to introduce a new variable, non-basic variable U1. Since this is corresponding to this component, so half of this side. So you can find this half is half 3/4, and so. So since this is not the optimal, because at least one of them is positive, so you can move on the third equation. You can use this value and this value. So my entering variable is here. So I have to introduce this. So you can express XB. You can find the value of the X2 from here. Substitute this value in X1. Okay, after solving you will get this. Similarly, you can substitute in S2 and F. Now since my non-basic variables are S1 and U1, so you find the entering variable by derivating it with respect to this and 0. Since both the values are less than or equal to 0, so there is no most positive part is there. So it means the current of this is my optimal. So how you find the optimal solution? You can substitute the value of non-basic variable, that is S1 as a 0, U1 as a 0 in this equation, you will get this value. So look at that, if you substitute U1 as a 0, this is 0, S1 as a 0, so X2 will be my 2/13. Look at this is 0, this is 0, X1 is this, and so. So this is the way to solve this Beal's method. That's one of the quite easy, simplest methods. So for the sake of simplicity, I just give you some practice problem for you. You can try to solve it. The answer is given to you. So if there is any doubt, you can contact me again at any of my address. Thank you very much.